So if you know a little bit of some of the products that we have in the maker and the innovator space, one of the key products that we've been selling the last few years is the Intel Edison. And Intel Edison was introduced in 2014. It was kind of our first foray into this market, using a modular approach to be able to make things a little bit simpler for developers. And it has a lot of performance in a very small package. And we found that people started picking it up for a variety of different applications. And it was very successful, and we're still seeing an increase in sales on Edison. But we've learned a lot from Edison, and we've learned and seen the need for additional capabilities. Edison doesn't easily allow us to access the graphics capabilities and imaging capabilities. The performance capabilities are limited by the frequency and the SoC within there. And when we look at the opportunity, the future opportunities out there, we see a huge amount of demand for new things that need to be done in a very small, bringing a lot of performance to the edge. And you can see in some of the demos yesterday of virtual reality, where people are starting to play around with virtual reality. Drones are a big issue, and there needs to be a lot more performance and capability on drones and on robots. And even on areas that are not typically in the drones and robots or the industrial sort of applications, such as the thud rumble that you've seen outside with the musical instrumentation, where they're constantly trying to get more and more performance and capability into their mixers and capability. And so this is the idea of that there are a lot of new usages and a lot of new capabilities that we don't really even always understand what they will be, but we know that there needs to be more performance at the edge. And so we want to take everything we learned from Edison and looking forward at more performance, more capability, and how do we actually bring that to market. So our objectives with that next generation are really talking about making performance ubiquitous. Andy Grove used to talk about ubiquitous computing. And if you think about ubiquitous computing, what it really would mean is that one is that the computing power kind of needs to sink into the background, kind of like a Cheshire cat's grin. And the way you're going to do that is making it incredibly small. And so what you'll start seeing is that when we're going through, when we're trying to make the ubiquitous computing on the Joule module, how small it can be. Very small, less than 10 grams, maybe something like 9 grams. And so it can fit in many, many more applications than what we could do before. Making it easy. We want to make sure that it is easier and faster for developers to bring products to market. And we're looking at all the barriers to entry in terms of people to bring product to market, such as regulatory, such as being able to buy prototypes very quickly and easily, and trying to relieve those as much as possible. Making it fast, again, the more steps that we can take care of, doing the high-speed I/O design that goes into the Joule module, doing the pre-certification allows people those developers to accelerate the trend market. Making it your way, I think one of the lessons that we've also learned is that different developers have different applications and different needs and different usages. And so we want to be able to provide a platform that gives developers the flexibility to do what they would like to do. And that can be developed flexibility in terms of the OSs that they're using, the software stacks that they're using, the sensors that they're using, allowing developers to modify the base platform in a way that meets their particular product needs. And making it real is the realization that we want to do a great job of integrating real sense cameras, the 3D imaging, effectively into the platform. So what we came up with was Intel Joule. And we'll try to talk through the rest of this presentation this morning is how we've gone through and how Joule is actually manifesting itself in all of those ways in terms of making it small, making it real, making it ubiquitous. And to do so, you know, we talk about pushing performance to the edge, just how small these things are. And here we had Joule not just as a standalone module, but also within a broader carrier card. And this carrier card is kind of a universal base carrier that has the capability of plugging whatever sensors you want into it. What you'll see is other people will have modified the carrier card to be able to get into their specific applications, making it smaller, making it less expensive, making it easier. And it's this flexibility of being able to change the carrier card and in the product itself that, that gives it lends a little bit more flexibility. So it's all very, very small. And so at this point, I'd like to actually talk through a, give you an example, give a flavor of what we can actually look at before we dive into all the details, so that you can see how it actually starts to manifest at the very end. In this, is soda. And soda is a...
I understand that. It's just the bartender.
Okay.
Place your order.
So I used his name and got into that space. So the soda is a virtual bartender, as he mentioned, designed by a company called V-Stone in Japan. And in this particular case, we can utilize soda as a bartender. Hello, soda. Hello, soda.
I have Coke and Diet Coke. Which do you prefer?
I'd like a beer, please. Hello, soda. I'd like a beer.
Good choice. I have three kinds of beer, a local Pilsner, an Oregon IPA, and a pale ale. Which one do you want?
Hello, soda. I'd like the pale ale.
Here is your pale ale.
Thank you, soda. So with soda, what you can see was able to use the real sense to be able to track, do the tracking, had the cameras built in, was able to do the voice recognition, and all of this was being done on the device. And the other thing that's interesting to note is that this was only started maybe 4 to 6 weeks ago. Right? So in a very short period of time, we were able to get the hardware running, getting the software running, do the integration, and actually have a lot of code working on the cloud, I mean, on the device. And it's indicative of that with this, the voice recognition and the cognition sort of software running on the edge allows us to, you know, having the processing power on the edge allows us to do a lot more things on the edge. This is one implementation. Another implementation is has been done by our partners at Microsoft. And it uses Windows 10 IoT core, and it's called Bamboo. And it does have the voice recognition. It does move back and forth. But from a demonstration perspective, what I thought would be interesting to show is a different implementation. And if you go and tweet onto hashtag Bamboo IDF, you can actually get a sensory tweet whether it'll turn it'll turn green versus red based on sentiment. And it's all running on the Azure cloud. So I think they started working on it, 6 weeks ago? 6 weeks ago, and that included several weeks of porting the Windows onto the device. So this, oh wow, it's already turning back and forth, so someone's actually tweeting back and forth on this. The point being is that it's very fast to be able to get the development done, get the prototypes up and running, and different developers have different requirements. In this particular case, they can do the language processing back up in the cloud, and one of the values of that is that they can actually do all the real-time translation. So they can do the real-time translation on the cloud. This has certain advantages. You can do all of many of the language processing on the edge when you don't necessarily have good connectivity. Different developers have different requirements, and we're trying to provide a platform that has the capability to allow people to do what they want to do based on the needs that they actually have. Okay, so now that I've kind of given you a little bit of an overview of the sort of things we can make and how it can be done, I'd like to actually bring up Ashish Pai, who is our engineering manager, to talk through both the SoC details of what we've done as well as the architecture.
Thank you, James. Well, good morning, folks.
Good morning.
Awesome. So, it's wonderful to be here with you all in San Francisco at the Moscone Center. And well, you guys have been introduced to Intel Joule. You've seen it yesterday in the keynote. You've seen the discussion with James a little bit more. But what I wanted to do is go into the details a little bit and talk to you guys about what Intel Joule, which you know is a platform, it really is a computer packed into a tiny module. But I also want to talk to you guys a little bit about what is the heart of Intel Joule. What makes it so special? And what is the core ingredient that makes Intel Joule a really powerful developer kit? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely pleased to announce to you guys the heart of Intel Joule, the Intel Atom processor T5700 and T5500. These are the two SKUs. And again, the demise of Broxton, as James mentioned, is greatly exaggerated. Okay, with that, I know when we talk about new products, everybody's interested about what comes with it. What's the architecture? What are the IPs? What are the domains? Let's take a little bit of a quick preview on what this is. This is the Atom processor 5700 based on the Broxton architecture, really our high-end mobile system on a chip. And this is built on Intel's latest and greatest 14 nanometers technology. What that means for everybody here is that you get the best in class in power and performance as part of this SoC architecture. Now, it all starts with the CPU core. What we have here is a 64-bit quad-core processor that is paired with our graphics and the media blocks. The graphics and the media also have the latest Gen 9 low-power architecture. Now, both the graphics and the compute in this processor represent a significant jump from a previous generation Atom class of products. And you guys have seen this. You've seen the theme in the keynotes and before. You hear 4K all over the place. Guess what? We bring to you, through the graphics and media, 4K processing power for both media, decode, and encode. And by the way, this is the first in the Atom class of products that we're bringing to you through the Broxton architecture to your disposal to push the boundaries of what's possible through Intel Joule. Now, for any SoC, just the CPU or the graphics is just alone not enough. You all care about more functional blocks that truly would enhance the experiences that's made possible to push the boundaries of what's even feasible within the computer and the machine vision fields. For that, we have a pretty powerful imaging processing unit as part of the Atom T57 architecture. Additionally, we also have a security coprocessor for enhanced security, an audio engine to be able to enable a variety of audio codecs and usages. And the imaging processor, by the way, handles multiple concurrent camera use cases to be able to push the limits to where you want to drive and where you want to go. And all of this is then compounded, added with a plethora of a variety of IOs and interfaces that we will expose, which are inbuilt into the SoC, exposed to Intel Joule for you guys to be able to do what you need to do through the carrier cards or whatever have you. With that, I'd like to also take and bring to your attention one other thing, which is the SoC footprint. James mentioned about how small Intel Joule is to be able to fit in a variety of form factors to drive ubiquitous computing. So we paid a lot of attention and focus on how small we can drive the footprint. This SoC comes with a 15 by 15 package. And part of the reason it is 15 by 15 is because we have a POP or a co-POP memory that sits on top of the SoC within that footprint. And we have LPDDR4 memory that's packaged along with the SoC. Now this is low power memory, so provides us lower power footprint, but also gives us 3200 megatransfers per second in bandwidth and a max data transfer rate of 25.6 gigabits per second. Now that's important because I know you care about 4K stuff. I know you care about running multiple applications at the same time. I know you care about driving multiple cameras and concurrent usages. This is the highway that enables you to do that. And we are extremely happy and proud to bring to you Intel Atom processor 5700 as part of Intel Joule to enable and open the gates for all these use cases. Now, architecture is one thing, but you also care about performance. And I mentioned that this is a significant jump in both compute as well as graphics performance. Now, pictures are worth 1,000 words. Here's some data. What I'm comparing here is basically the T5700 processor with Intel Edison, which you guys are familiar with. Now, as you can see, for single-threaded applications, for CPU, we have more than a And if you care about multiple or multi-threaded applications, this is a quad-core CPU, and we get more than a 10x jump. And that, my friends, is significant. It's huge. And this is what Intel Joule brings to bear. And we hope that the developer community out here embraces this and pushes it to the realm of what's possible by exposing all of these performance-related aspects. Now, CPU performance is one thing. There are folks here who may wonder, oh, I care about graphics. What's in it for me? Maybe I care about both. What do I look forward to? Well, here's some data comparing again a 5700 latest generation Broxton class processor versus its previous generation in the Atom family, which is the Z8500. As you can see, once again, for graphics, more than a 40% jump for GX benchmark. And this is also possible, like I mentioned, we have 80 execution units for the latest Gen 9 low-power architecture. So, my friends, again, this is a significant jump in both compute and graphics performance, all packed within the SoC for Intel Joule. But wait, just graphics and CPU performance alone isn't enough. We all know that we care about usages and end products where performance alone doesn't cut it. We need the power as part of the equation. And the chart on the right is indicative of what we can do and how we are trying to strive to get more and better performance while at the same time lowering our power envelope. Being part of 40 nanometer process technology enables that as well. And the goodness that it all comes together brings to bear in the Intel Joule and the Atom processor that we're sharing here. As you can see, for the dynamic range from below a watt to about 2.5 watts, we have almost a 50% jump in the performance per watt story. So you've got great CPU performance, you've got awesome graphics performance, and you've got a great performance in the performance per watt story as well. This is a jump, a significant jump for what Intel Joule brings to you as part of the overall family with the Atom processor as well. Now, we talked about Intel Joule as a platform, we talked about the processor that's part of it. What I'd like to do is also share some details on the architecture of the module itself and the other ingredients that come along with it to make it a holistic system that you guys can really take advantage of. And the base carrier card that comes along with it. So this is a tutorial view of what the module looks like. We've talked about the application processor a bit, and you've seen the advantages and the performance and the power that it brings to bear. Paired along with the Broxton or the application processor is the Intel's dual band wireless AC8260 chip that supports both 2.4 and 5 gigahertz operations. It is a 802.11 AC capable chip and Intel's latest third generation a wireless chip targeting high performance use cases now that's paired along with the application processor that comes with it on the module. The fantastic thing about it is it's pre-certified. Takes you much farther along the way as part of your development cycle. It has the smallest PCB area for the 2x2 MIMO implementation. Again, our focus on small form factor, lower BOM cost, and world-class power consumption. And you know, with 802.11 AC, you get a bunch of features, whether it be timestamp, whether it be synchronization, whether it be ACS enabling and concurrent multi-channel use cases. And Bluetooth 4.2 compliance is also supported as part of this module. Paired with the application processor and the wireless chip is our power management IC that allows for and is basically optimized for fine grain power management. It has subsystems of voltage regulation, CMOS, GPIOs, and a real-time clock. It's controlled and programmed for the I2C interface. And what you can see here, which is on the back side, is the fourth ingredient, which is a storage, an eMMC storage that's 5.0 compliant, and you can go up to 16 gigabytes. So you have these four critical parts of the system all packed into this tiny module. So what we have done is taken the complex aspects of the system, designed it in a small form factor for you to be able to drive faster time to market and accelerate innovation. This power pack module also comes pre-certified. We've done the regulatory aspects for you, whether it be FCC, CE, UL compliance, and so on and so forth. So this truly is our next generation hardware with enhanced features and capabilities that we bring to bear for the developer community. Now, when we talk about ubiquitous computing, it's great to have all of this performance, form factor, all enabled for you, but you also care about a variety of industry standard interfaces that you want to have connectors, that you want to use it for all the use cases that you want to drive. What I want to talk to and share here are some of the connectors that we are exposing and some of the interfaces that we are exposing as part of Joule. What you see on the top, the horizontal ones on the top at the bottom and below the horizontal ones are essentially 2x50 pin connectors that exposes a bunch of standard interfaces. HDMI for display, SDIO for SD use cases. And we have a couple of SPICE ports if you want to add additional storage or Ethernet or mini panels, whatever have you. More I2C, I2 ports for audio and sensor capabilities. And of course, we have high-speed USB 3.0 and USB 2.0 exposed as well. We also support on-the-go functionality. What that means is you can use this device as a host mode or as a device mode. We have support for both of them. But that itself is not enough. I know you guys want to go and create many innovative devices, whether it be in robotics, be it in drones, or many of the verticals that have not yet come through. You need configurable IOs to be able to match the use cases where you need to go. In this case, we have 8 dedicated GPIOs, general purpose IOs, and up to 48 GPIOs that are configurable either through a BIOS or an OS setting. These are highly configurable GPIOs, including multiple pull-ups or interrupt-capable ones for enabling a variety of use cases. Also, we have 4 PWMs to be able to, again, meet your requirements for either robotics fields or drones or other market use cases. So this is very configurable to push the boundaries and limits of what you can do with Joule. And we have more for you. We know that you need imaging and sensing capabilities to push and expand the realm of what's possible on the computer and machine vision fields. So coming later this year, we're going to expose MIPI-based cameras. The connectors that you see on the right and the left, the vertical ones, are essentially reserved for MIPI CSI. And we also support up to 4 multiple concurrent camera use cases through the MIPI connectors. So all of this is coming to bear as part of Joule. Now, we talked about performance, we talked about the form factor, and now you guys want to look at the dimensions of how small is small. Well, we have packed all of this into a really small space, and it's really 48 millimeters long, 24 millimeters deep, and just 5 millimeters in height. And that even includes the thermal transfer shield for managing thermals. So again, all of this performance is all packed, designed in, validated, optimized into this small form factor that you can pick it up and develop a plethora of products that you want to get into. And our goal is to partner with you all here to get Joule in the largest variety of form factors that's possible and extend the realm of what's possible. Now, We've talked again about the architecture. We've talked again about the module and the bunch of interfaces that you have. What we also want to do is make it easy for you to be able to take those interfaces, take what's all the powerful stuff that's in Intel Joule, and get it out to you through some industry standard connectors so that you can download your software and get going and start prototyping. So we're pleased to announce the Intel Joule based carrier reference board that comes along with it in the package. Really, the base carrier board achieves three purposes. First, it connects the module onto this carrier board. Number two, it breaks out all the module interfaces to an industry standard connector. And of course, the third one is to deliver power from the board into the module. Now, there are a bunch of connectors, as you can see here, that are part of this carrier board. Type A, Type C, USB connectors, micro HDMI, micro SD cards. There's also a micro USB for debug purposes, MIPI DSI, and so on and so forth. You can attach shields to the headers out there, both the top and the bottom. Also, the carrier card has the EEPROM. And the reason I mentioned that is because in the developer community or in the maker community, you want to be able to customize. You want to be able to take things and make things to suit your needs. So the EEPROM is configurable, it's customizable. What it really does is personalizes the details of the board and conveys it to the module. Soon we're going to provide a tool for all of you guys to be able to program the EEPROM and configure the BIOS to be able to discover some peripherals that you may attach to it. What that really does for you is you can customize your board to really what you want to build. And this becomes a reference design that really accelerates your time to market with some easy customizations and configurations and bring your products to market much faster. And this carrier board is going to be open sourced. We're going to open source the design, the schematics, and the layout for you guys to be able to take this as a fantastic starting point and give you a baseline that enables a quick, validated, high confidence path to start prototyping and enabling the product. The future is what you make, and we are here to partner with you guys to make it easy and make it fast. That's all what Intel Joule is all about. That's what we want to enable, that's what we want to drive. Further, to lower the barriers of innovation, I would like to invite my esteemed colleague Jim Chase to the stage to walk you through this. Thanks for being here. Thank you.
How about the hardware?
Yeah.
Well, as we all know, hardware gets us a good portion of the way. One of the things we wanted to also extend is our software capability. On previous generation products, we've limited ourselves a little bit based on some of the things we could actually accomplish from an operating system perspective. And we wanted to take a look all the way from the top to the bottom on the software stack and start with the bottom to get where we want to go, especially for the developers. A lot of developer community feedback on our different products, and we wanted to make sure that we optimize every single level. The very first level that we wanted to start off with was the BIOS. I don't know how many complaints or interesting, you know, bits of feedback we have on proprietary firmware. Okay, anybody run into a problem with that?
No problems.
Yeah, typically the community comes back and says, "Oh, yet another evil vendor tree." But what we wanted to be able to do is provide a way for you to optimize your own BIOS. So we decided to go for a little bit more unified approach in this case. So at the base level, we're putting on a UEFI BIOS. Okay. And on top of that, we're going to open source it. Okay. So a little later this year, you'll be able to have access, full access to the majority of the elements that are in the BIOS. One of the things that Ashish had pointed out earlier was that the double EEPROM that's on the base carrier, that's actually read by BIOS, and it configures the I.O. of the Joule module so that you can have one Joule module in your SKU or in your inventory, and depending upon what it is the carrier is that you're actually plugging into, it will self-configure. Okay. So that makes it a little bit easier for the manufacturing aspects of things. So there's all kinds of other things that we've added into the BIOS, and you'll see that over time. And again, we'll be open sourcing the majority of that BIOS here later this year. The other thing that we get a lot of feedback on is, of course, you know, the Linux kernels that we support. We're big fans of Yocto project and things like that, and that helps a lot of our development. But you know, one of the things that we don't want to be stuck with is an old version of Linux. So our first implementation of Linux that we're coming out with is a 4.4 implementation on the kernel. But one of the things that our BSP team has really been conscious of is making sure that all the patches that we do are from upstream Linux. And what that means to you is that a little later this year, roughly Linux 4.9 will be fully upstreamed on this platform. Ask of our team, and they were able to accomplish that with a lot of help across all of Intel. So again, we're big fans of Yocto project, and of course we're going to provide you with a reference platform built with Yocto. But at the same time, we understand there's going to be a lot of requirements for lots of different other types of distributions. One of the more popular ones out there, we're going to support Ubuntu Core, and we're working with the Canonical guys to be able to provide you with Ubuntu Core. But the nice thing about, you know, being fully upstreamed is if you have a Linux distribution and you want to put on a random Linux distribution, pretty much any Linux distribution will just drop right on and go. In fact, you don't have to wait until, you know, 4.9. If you want to go ahead and, from the community perspective, start porting those implementations now, it'd be great. But one of the other things that we're able to accomplish with the UEFI BIOS is we're not stuck completely in one domain. Okay? So working with Microsoft and our internal development teams, we now are going to support Microsoft Windows 10 IoT Core on the platform as well. Okay, James mentioned early on about reducing time to market. And time to market is, phases are in a lot of different areas. Not just hardware, but also software, but also your base carriers, all the other libraries and other things like that you're going to start with. Okay, for those of you from 30 years ago when we had to bake our own BSPs, we had to write all our own device drivers, we had to practically write our entire operating system to do what we needed to do. It takes a long time. You complicate that with things like worldwide compliance. Okay, if you have a Wi-Fi device, how do you deploy that in European Union? How do you deploy it in Africa? How do you deploy it in China? Okay. So those are all the kind of the big key elements that we target on these platforms to reduce the time to market for you. Okay. So you have a design and compute module that has POP packaging, very, very small pitch, very, very tight packaging, and you want to sell 1,000 units. Well, most small developers that have small volume type applications, maybe 1 to 10,000, trying to go off to a manufacturer somewhere in the world and tell them that you only want 10,000 units lifetime with a POP package, you're probably going to get turned down a lot. Okay? So that's one of the values that we are going to provide when we create this type of module. We use our girth, our capability, we aggregate those volumes, we create that time to market advantage, taking away all the requirements that you have now to create the module and allow you to accelerate and work just specifically on your application. OS level implementation, again, we want to make sure we lower the barrier across the board, whether it's a Linux-based platform, whether it's a Windows 10 IoT Core implementation, or maybe anything you want to put on there. But from our perspective, we want to make sure that we have a plethora of things to pick with to start off with, so that you don't have to worry about that aspect of things. The other aspect is, you know, the carrier board concepts. We put that on here because, you know, the carrier board for a module is going to be, you know, some amount of engineering. Well, what if you had a plethora of carrier boards to start off with? Or maybe you had an ecosystem that allowed you to rapidly develop your carrier boards based on whatever your application is. Those are the things we target as well. We use a third-party ecosystem to help us do that. And of course, we globally certify. The nice thing about your A260 module, and a different actually even from the Epson platform, it's 2.5 and 5 gig compatible worldwide. We don't do any restrictions or limitations on client versus AP mode either. Automatically configures based on where your location is in the world. And then of course, you still have to actually write your app. We're not gonna do that for you. And you have to produce it and sell it. We're not gonna do that for you either. But what we're gonna do is we're gonna take those very complicated, very expensive elements and try to compress them as far as we can for you. So what happens is, now you have a much, much smaller investment in your overall cost to entry. So your time to market is very low. Your entry cost is much lower. And you can either outsource your custom board, you can build a custom board, or you maybe even buy a custom board. So hopefully we accomplish that particular task with that. All right, so we talked a little bit about the operating system implementations, the hardware implementations, but as you know at Intel, we're big on the ecosystem. And this is one of the outreach to you as developers to provide, help us provide, you know, different ecosystem elements and be able to accelerate your products into your customers' domains as well. So we talked about the SoC, the OS, a little bit about the carrier boards, but there's a whole bunch of other stuff that we're gonna come out with too. So development kits, the first one we have is our small development kit is kind of a generic breakout board. We're gonna have a whole series of kits as well. We're also going to put a whole bunch of library extensions in place for you as well. So this is really targeted for, you know, imaging applications, so a lot of computer vision libraries and things like that we're going to include with the platform. And then of course, because it is a computer vision implementation, we're going to integrate it with Intel RealSense. So I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute, but one of the things I think that's key is the ability to be able to rapidly develop your carrier board. We tried to make that absolutely as simple as possible with the breakouts that we have on there. And I think, you know, what really shows out, and go to the showcase, please go to the third floor and see some of the showcase elements that we have out there. We already have some of our demos that have already created their own custom carriers. In fact, one company has created 6 custom carriers. Easy Robot, at the same time they were developing their prototype with Windows 10 IoT Core, they were also creating their base board. And so when they showed up to IDF, they had their custom carrier ready to rock and roll. So you can see that Easy Robot demo upstairs as well. So the guys from Gumsticks have and their Geppetto product, they've ripped out 6 carrier boards already for it. They are already up and running today. So they have it already baked in their ecosystem. So there's a lot of things you can do very, very quickly with the existing operating ecosystem that we have today. So one of the other things that I want to point out is up in the demo area, you're going to see a lot of RealSense demos. You're going to see other imaging demos as well. Those RealSense cameras are our prototypes for some of the things that we're going to do in the future. So one of the things that we're going to want to provide to you is a RealSense developer kit. Because of Joule's performance, because of the optimization that we've done on the platform itself from a hardware perspective, we are also going to optimize libraries, and we're also going to optimize it with a particular RealSense camera, the ZR300. And so later on this year, you'll be able to take advantage of the performance level of Joule, the performance level of the new ZR300 combined in a kit, and be able to provide a phenomenal base of computer vision applications to your customers. We're also going to make this solution available through our broad channel. What we really like to see is independent developers targeting specific computer vision applications use it as part of their go-to-market strategy as well. So we'd like to talk to you about that. And the other thing is that we know that we're committed to the ecosystem. We want to take Joule. We want to create a very robust platform across the board, whether it's computer vision, might be gateway, high performance gateway applications, might be micro gateway applications, battery handheld, instrumentation. I mean, there's a plethora of devices that can benefit from this type of product. So we're going to create a series of kits in the same vein as our Intel RealSense Developer Kit and provide that to you as a starting point with a full set of libraries, operating system, and everything else so that you can accelerate your time to market. So when is it going to be available? Guess what? You can buy them today, downstairs. Okay? That's pretty cool. So we want to make sure we hurried quite rapidly to make sure that we could get this available to you today. You can go downstairs in the Newegg store, pick one up. Before you leave today, make sure you pick up a little $30 off coupon. Okay, Jay and Rex and some of these other guys will help you with all of that. But also, you're going to be able to buy them through some traditional channels, Mouser and Newegg today, and then other distributors will be coming on board as well. We're going to have the high-end product available first, so the 570 module itself also will have it in bulk pack as well. But you'll be able to buy the module by itself. You'll also be able to buy the module with the base carrier as well, immediately. Later on this year, about October, we're going to have the lower tier standard module implementation, which isn't all that low tier, right? 1.5 gig per core. Still an awesome product for excellent value. So, in today's discussion, we talked about making it ubiquitous, right? Pushing that boundary of performance down to places where it really has never been. We're talking about a price performance category and size category that is unmatched today. We want to really, really accelerate that across lots of really cool applications, especially in machine vision and instrumentation and media. We want to make it easy and fast for you. So you can immediately get units today. You can get carriers on board today. You can take this modular architecture, create your own carriers. You can take operating systems that exist today and build your own. There's a lot of different options that you can do to make it your way as well. And we want to make sure that we get some feedback from you on different things that you may want in the future as well. One of the things that we always like to push onto our developers, especially at environments like this, is tell us what you want to invent. Tell us what you are going to invent. Tell us how you're going to push the boundaries of this platform. Help us help you.
So I'm going to, as usual, take a look at the technology, focusing on what's new this year. And then we're going to go into new application areas. We're really excited how the technology we built is finding its way into all kinds of exciting systems and applications. So I'm going to spend time on that as well. Hopefully I'll leave some time for questions. Do you have the clock going so I can track myself? Thank you. So as usual, we start by asking ourselves, why bother sensifying devices? Why build all this technology so devices can have human-like sensing? To answer the question, we go back in time. In fact, we go back half a billion years ago. I might have some people that have listened to me before. Something major happened that biologists consider to be an important phenomenon in the history of biology. What happened 500 million years ago?
Complex life.
So there was literally an explosion of evolution, where life forms went from a few simple species, and it exploded into an enormous variation of organisms within a span of something like 60 to 70 million years ago. And it's called the Cambrian explosion. Well, biologists have researched for many decades on what really caused it. You know, you go down to the lower levels of rock formation during the beginning of the Cambrian era, and you see few simple organisms. You just go 10, 20 million years over and look at the rock layers above them, and you see this diversity of life forms, millions of variations. So something happened. Now we think we know. And there are environmental reasons, like there were enough oxygen in the environment to sustain bigger life forms. The other one is the formation of ozone layer in the upper atmosphere. If you're getting bombarded by cosmic rays, then life doesn't get a chance to flourish. So there was the ozone layer that definitely helped. But the third one, which was debated, and we think it's settled now, is the most relevant for this presentation, is that that's the time when these complex sensory systems evolved. The binocular visual systems that allow species to see the world in 3D, the vestibular systems for accurate motion tracking, the touch, and all that evolved during the Cambrian era. So the reason we think it's quite interesting to look at biology is because of the explosion that we're starting to see in computing devices and systems. Well, perhaps the lack of sophisticated sensing systems, the perceptual system, was holding us back. But there's nothing holding us back now, because we are able to build human-like sensing and understanding technology and put them into devices of all form factors, ranging from virtual reality and augmented reality devices on the left to autonomous machines of all form factors, drones flying in the sky, to terrestrial intelligent robots. To the right, systems that can easily create 3D scans of people and objects for people, allowing you to track your fitness, allowing you to virtually dress, the example that you see up on the top. So when you add human-like sensing, you're starting to see an explosion of different kinds of computing devices that could not have been there before. That's what we find exciting in the realm of real sense. It's what is pushing us to invent and advance the sensing technologies faster. But it's more than just sensing. When you study the biological systems, it's really a set of capabilities that we have to replicate in technology to mimic the human perceptual system. Obviously, it starts with sensors, being able to gather the data and process them and from the environment and people around. That's hardware. And we're going to show you products that are inspired by them. The next two layers are software and systems. It's not just about sensing, but it's about understanding what you see. You know, I sense the light through my visual system, lights that's generated in the sources here, reflected from your face and the chairs, coming into my eye. That's sensing. But then I'm understanding what I see. I see Jay sitting there, I see Sagi sitting over there. I understand what I see. I'm able to understand the 3D environment. So we need to build software algorithms as part of the perceptual system. The last part is learning. If you have to program the machine to do everything that it does, it will be very limited in its capabilities. We have all seen for the last few years the explosive development in deep learning with all kinds of machine learning techniques, including deep learning. So we deploy that technology to evolve our machines to be able to then learn based on what it senses and what it understands. That's the whole stack for real sense. And I'm going to walk you through some of that as we walk through the technology and the applications. So visual sensing at the heart of real sense. We wanted to capture the world in 3D. And I want to point out here is that this is not just about looking at the biological systems and sticking two cameras. It would be too simple. You just put two cameras in there. Pay attention to the visual cortex at the back of your brain. Human visual system is amazing in its real-time understanding of the 3D world, not just because we have binocular visual system, binocular eyes, but also the fixed function hardware that we have that evolved over millions of years, and we had to learn from that to build specific hardware as part of the RealSense modules. I'll point to that. But the next one, sometimes we take for granted, that's the human vestibular system. And I'm going to spend a minute talking about that. So this is a cross-section of the human head, the 2 ears you can see on the two sides. But pay attention to the red circles. Inside them, you got 3 mutually perpendicular rings, both sides of the head, and they're filled with fluid. So when you move in a direction, the fluid rushes to the back, and the neurons are able to detect that, and those are your body's balancing system. It's your body's motion sensor, the accelerometer gyroscope combination that you have in your mobile devices. We have to learn that as well, because we humans are amazing tracking systems. You know, as I am now walking around here looking at the room, without me knowing, I am constantly creating a 3D map of the visual field here. I'm creating a map, and I'm trying to localize myself within that 3D map every moment. And then I'm using those data to track myself. And I'm using the visual and the vestibular systems to do that. So hold on to the thought as I come to RealSense. So we wanted to then build systems that mimic, I'm going to be humble here, that there's long ways to go before you can claim that you have copied human perceptual system, but we take steps every day that we're at work. So RealSense, before I show you the hardware, let me just then explain the functions of it. So first of the camera system on the RealSense module, you can capture the color picture that you see in the middle. We're all familiar with that. You snap a color picture, which is a projected image of the rich 3D world. But what's unique to depth cameras, in real sense, is the depth map that you see on the right. It just looks like a gray picture. Everybody familiar with depth map? Not all of you, so I'm going to explain a little bit. So every pixel on the right, on the left picture, or on the color picture there, has a corresponding pixel here on the depth map, which is an indication of how far from the imaging device that point is. So that this is coded in 8-bit. So brighter points are nearer, and the darker points are further away. So 8-bit image, so 256 levels of distance. When you have a pair of these images, synchronized, mapped, captured at real time, it's at 60 frames per second, you can build machines that see the world like we humans do. And by the way, we also have a motion sensor on some of the RealSense modules that require detecting motions and tracking. So what can you do with that? We can reconstruct the world in real time like we do. So this is a view of real time reconstruction from a RealSense device. You can make out structures like chairs and people and table. So this is what really is real time 3D visual sensing. 3D visual inertial sensing system needs to do. So that's the functional part of it. Let me quickly show you the actual products that we've been shipping in millions of units now. So they're finding applications in many, many systems, and I will show you some of them. But in quick short, RealSense, as Brian said in his keynote, is a family of products. Depending on the systems that they're deployed in, we have optimized the ingredients and the functions accordingly. So we have RealSense SR300 family of products that's optimized for short-range user interaction applications, where we paired those up with software such as full finger skeletal tracking technology for gesture recognitions, facial tracking and recognition technologies such as Microsoft Windows Hello for logging into PCs, and background segmentation technology like virtual green screen in your gaming, streaming, or video conferencing. You're calling into Skype or Tencent PQ chat, and you're calling in to the meeting, a business meeting from your living room. How about putting up your office picture in the back, right? So it's like a green screen without going green screen. So that's the family products that's ramped in very high volume by now. The next product is the LR200, that's for the long range usages. That's the product that that's going into the unique Typhoon H drone. I'm going to talk about that a little bit, that you saw in Brian's keynote. Model ZR300 takes the LR200 and adds sophisticated, accurate motion sensing on it with a fisheye camera for peripheral feature tracking and an IMU on board, like a really visual vestibular equivalent of a tracking technology. And with that, we have a neat set of software libraries ranging from 3D scanning. Anybody recognizes this gentleman? That's Brian. That's a business person here. You want funding for your project, you might as well use your CEO as the model. augmented reality, where you can superimpose virtual objects onto the real world with correct geometry, occlusion, collision, and physical effects. Real-time tracking, I have a lot more to say about that. And lastly, the holy grail, where you're not only recognizing and understanding the 3D structures, but then you're learning to tell what those are. And I'll have some stuff to talk about that as well. So that's real sense products that I've been shipping, and you should have already been known about that. What's exciting today is this IGF. It's for the first time that we have revealed the next generation of real sense camera, the 400 series. And it just everything gets better. Let me just tell you some numbers, which we have not disclosed before. We capture over 50 million 3D points per second, actually 55 million 3D points per second. That's three times higher than what you can do with today's real sense cameras, which are already by far state of the art compared to other solutions in the market. So we're really pushing the points of high fidelity, high resolution 3D capture with our next gen. It's going to be, it's more flexible, it's smaller form factor. I think Brian already showed in his keynote, really pushes the limits of form factor for a high performance dev camera. It's lower power, smaller form factor. You might say, well, everything seems better here. And the answer is yes. We're really proud about this product. It's going to be sampling to our customers very soon. So let's go forward. What I'm going to do is just show you an early view of why we are so excited with this new camera. So you're talking for a ride, outdoor environment, we're inside a car and looking out into the world with 400. And I'm going to show you a live video, a video of the color picture plus the corresponding depth map. Again, for those of you that are not familiar with depth map, it's a pseudo-colored depth map. The red points are the ones that are farther away. You know, you can see all the way up to 60 meters here, run out of scale. And as you get closer, gray, blue, light blue, right? So this is like a pseudo-colored indication of the depth map for every pixel. So let me just play this. Outdoor environment works equally well indoor as well because we have IR laser projector. You get the picture. You'll see a lot more from us as we roll out this product out of the market. But we think that it's going to push the limits of system integration that require real-time 3D sensing. Okay, into the applications. So a lot has been said about virtual reality. So we decided to work on this quietly and confidentially until this IGF, Brian's keynote, where we wanted to look at the virtual reality and augmented reality world and solve some major problems that are there in today's system. The goal for the world, for a lot of us in many companies and universities, have been the same. Here we wanted to merge the real and the virtual. So if you want to merge the real and the virtual, I think we can have some fun. So first of all, then you want to understand what is real. And I quote Morpheus from Matrix. How many people watched Matrix, the 1999 movie? So then remember Morpheus asking, so what is real? And then he repeats, so how do you define real? He comes up with an answer. If you're talking about what you can feel, what you can smell, what you can taste and see, then real is simply the electrical signals that are interpreted by your brain. So let's pause for a second. Oh, you went too fast on it. To me, you guys are simply the electrical signals that are zipping around in my cerebral cortex. The reality is what sensations are created inside your cerebral cortex, the gray matter on your brain. So the real world is the one that I, a model that I create in my brain based on the perceptual sensing signals that I receive. So in this, there's a bit of a smell and tactile information as I'm walking around. To me, the world is just simply the signals in my brain. When you recognize that, then it's about engineering. What can you do to create the kind of signals that would be created in your cerebral cortex in the real world? Then you solve the problem. Well, can it be done? So to explain that, let me welcome my old friend. How many of you remember this one? Very few, so I'm going to play this. So this, I'm going to show an example of can you create sensations in the cerebral cortex that gives you the fools you to believe in you're in the real world. So enjoy the frog's action for a second. Frog. It is a real frog. Because it created some real pain for the guy. So we think the reason it's relevant is because perhaps we, there's no way to tell, but like it's likely that the signals that are being generated in the visual cortex of the frog probably are almost the same as those created when it's surrounded by real insects. Right? Well, then you might say, it's just a frog, right? Stupid animal. We are humans, we're smarter. Can you fool the humans? So let me do a trick that's pretty common in, among the computer vision people. I'm going to ask a question and let's see what you think about this. So what I'd like to know, what do you think is the rough ratio of the length of the table on the left to the length of the table on the right? Like 1.5 to 2 or 3? What do you think? What's the ratio of the length? About half. How about the width? Is that also about half? Right? So you know, we are smart humans, we have a rich cerebral cortex, very much more sophisticated than the frog. And so we think that it's about 2 times the length and 2 times the width. So I'm going to simply take this table on the left, rotate it, we're not going to resize it, and put it on top of the other one. What do you think the length is? 1 to 1. How about the width is 1 to 1? Let me just put it back. No resizing. Can you believe it's 1 to 1? We can fool your perceptual system. We can create signals that are that can fool you. Let me give you another one. This one, Professor Edelson in MIT. And now that the last one, you know, it was a trick, so you're probably going to compensate for that. But let's be honest. So what's the ratio of the brightness between the square A and square B? Roughly twice the brightness, 3 times the brightness? You said they are the same, right? So actually they are. So what I'm going to do in the next slide, I'm going to just block the rest of the image and only keep the square A and square B out and see what happens. They're actually exactly the same. And the decades of research that has been done in understanding human perceptual system is what's been brought to practice as you create virtual reality. Because let's face it, virtual reality is fake, but we just have to do enough to fool you into believing or creating the sensation in your perceptual system as if you're in the real world. Then our jobs as engineers are done. Right? That's what we want to do. Now you might say, well, VR devices are already trying to do that. And we already discussed some of the things you have to do. You have to solve the tracking problems so you don't get the visual and vestibular mismatch doesn't make you sick. You need to reduce the latencies from the sensing to the displays. A lot of knowledge out there, companies are building technologies. So what does Intel want to do here? Well, there's a lot to reality than just fooling your visual system. It's not real when you have to stay connected to a PC and you can only move around 3 to 4 feet. It breaks the sense of realism. And I can bet you it breaks the sense of realism when you go run into a wall or hit the chair with your knee. It breaks realism. So you want to be able to avoid collision. It breaks realism when to manipulate objects, you got to now remove the headset and look for your controller. For simple applications, you simply want to raise your hand because that's what you do in real life. When you lift your hand and you don't see it, there's a term for it. Psychologists call it lack of proprioception cues. If you ever lift your hand and you don't see that, you panic. And that's what happens in VR environment as well. So you need to be able to see the real world. Multi-user interactions, I need to be able to see the real world around me, that's mixed reality. So this is what we wanted to do. Our answer, as we work really hard over months, is Project Alloy. So you've already seen the form factor. We have a device here. I think Brian showed you the system, right? But let me do one click down, just to show you what's inside. So unlike the VR devices of today, what we did, in order to enable a completely untethered and all-in-one design, we had to integrate the compute functions in there. And to get great VR experience, you need strong graphics. You can simply put your phone up into the headset, then you are limited by compute power. To go untethered, we also have to integrate sensing and tracking technologies inside. So that's where RealSense comes in. With the visual inertial tracking that we discussed in the leading up to the RealSense discussion was critical in being able to do this, what is called as inside-out tracking. You simply put your headset on and you can take a walk around your house or a large floor. If you have to set up your room with tracking systems and you have to stay confined in a rectangle, then you're not in real environment. So I'd like Lucy to show some demonstrations of Project Alloy device. So here she is in the virtual world with some virtual boxes, which she's going to manipulate with her real hands. You see, she's simply reaching out, no controller, reaching out and pushing things off. So that's merging the real and the virtual. Your real hand interacting with the virtual. By the way, the sound would have been great here. She's breaking the glass walls by simply punching into them. You've seen the gold one there in Brian's keynote. Now we get to show you the titanium one, where you can sculpt and shape objects by simple natural interactions. You have very fine control because you have the full skeletal information for your hand. So you're able to manipulate stuff. What can developers do when you release this API? This, by the way, is awesome in the lab. So for those of you that would like to play with it and don't want to wait too long, let us know. We can invite you back to our lab. We're really working hard to release this to the developer ecosystem. Thank you, Lucy. Okay, so that was Project Alloy. Let me move to the next area, and that of autonomous machines. And we'll cover that with the airborne ones. Any of you are drone aficionados? If you are, you're probably frustrated like we are when you have to worry about the drone hitting into the tree or a structure, because it's very hard when the drone is far away and you have to make sure it doesn't fly into things. At the same time, you want to do what you want to do so the drone can take your picture. So with RealSense, we're able to bring the real-time 3D scanning and understanding capability to the drones. Let me show you a video that's from Unique Typhoon H. And it's different from many other systems in that it's not simply detecting occlusion and stopping, but what it is doing is we have this RealSense device integrated right in the front with full real-time 3D scanning capability. So as it flies around and comes across structures, it's able to create 3D map and then go around with sophisticated flight planning and autonomous navigation technology we have from Ascending Technologies. We're able to combine collision avoidance along with autonomous navigation as into the drones. It's quite groundbreaking. For those of you that have played with drones, I encourage you to get your hands on this. So we don't want to stop with just commercially available prosumer systems, but we also announced the Aero platform to make it easy for developers to build UAVs as research platforms or your next product. The Aero platform is going to make it really easy for you to build a complete drone and combine real sense-based vision system. And that is a complete drone developer kit that we're also going to have out there. So if you're a drone maker, you might just want to buy or get the drone development kit. But if you'd like to build applications and usage models on top of drone, then you will get the ready-to-fly drone kit and build your applications. We're really excited about this, and there's a lot of feedback we're getting from the ecosystem that would like to get their hands on it quick. Let me switch gear and get to robotics. So autonomous machines, they have always been almost here. You just have to see one of the science fiction movies where you see robots among you. Well, people would argue that robots have already taken over the society. But where are they? They're in the Intel fab. You go into a state-of-the-art Intel fab, you'll see that the wafers are moved from station to station and with automated systems. You go to a Tesla manufacturing automotive assembly house, it's taken over by robots. But how come they're not here among us, serving us water, or you know, helping us in our day-to-day life? They are here. The examples I'm giving you here, hopefully some of you are familiar with them. This is the Savioc Hotel Butler robot that's deployed in several hotels, including the Aloft Hotel in Cupertino. Last time I was presenting somewhere, there was someone there in the audience who actually stayed at the hotel. And she ordered a hair dryer. She said the hair dryer broke. And she was surprised to see the robot show up because it had mapped the entire hotel and it's able to go from point A to point B by itself. Along the way, it's able to autonomously navigate around people, obstacles, and do the stuff at 12 p.m. in the night that you have to struggle to find a human being to do. Other examples, this is a nine-bot Segway robot. Besides riding the Segway, if you want to take a little walk in the park, you set it on a follow me mode so it can follow you around, like your pet does. Asus Zenbo robot that was unveiled at Computex as your next home companion robot. I encourage you to see the YouTube videos of it. I don't have time to go into it. Pretty exciting proof points that are coming to market. Today, I'd like to invite Brad, the CEO of Sydney Robotics, to share with us the exciting work he's doing in service robots with the AirSense.
Great. Thank you, Rachan.
Clicker.
Yes. Sorry.
And thank you all for the opportunity to share a bit more about what we're doing at Sydney and the work we're doing with RealSense. At Sydney, we build a fully autonomous mobile robot called Tally. And Tally is designed to help retailers better manage the state of merchandise in their store. Specifically, Tally helps them understand if their products are in the right place, properly stocked, and have the right price. Tally actually operates during normal store hours alongside customers and shoppers, and requires no infrastructure changes to the environment. We're purely using computer vision. Tally is powered by Intel through the use of an i7 NUC platform, and we use multiple RealSense cameras to better understand the world around us. In the following video, you will see Tally actually use its RealSense cameras to avoid an obstacle in its environment. This is from one of our retail customers, and as Tally approaches the end of the aisle, you actually see through its cameras that it will encounter a shopping cart and a shopper. Through the use of RealSense, we can reliably and safely avoid these obstacles. Why we liked RealSense as a robotics company is its small form factor, its low cost, the reliable supply chain from people like Intel, and most importantly, Intel's commitment to open source. So there's a Linux driver available for the RealSense, as well as a ROS package. For those of you that don't know, the robot operating system is a set of open source tools and libraries that allow you to effectively build robot applications. Tally is built upon ROS as well as other robots like Savioc, and we encourage any of you with interest in robotics to try ROS as well as try RealSense with the ROS driver. If you're interested in seeing Tally in action, I encourage you to come to the Intel Tech Pavilion downstairs and see Tally and RealSense. We're in booth 371.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you, Ben.
Sure.
Thank you. But it's come by. It's a very nice setting that Brad and team has there with a real environment mimicking a retail system, and you see Tali in action there. So that was robotics. We're really excited about this, that we're able to bring the sensors and brains into making robots smart. I want to switch gear to another new area, and that's of 3D scanning. Well, it's a relatively new area for commercial deployments. We don't typically have devices in everybody's home that we can use to simply take a 3D object or a human and make a 3D model out of it. It's almost like years ago, maybe decades ago, you didn't have a printer in your home, and there was no way to replicate stuff. There's a lot of development that are going on in the 3D printers, and in the past we have shown you handheld 3D scanning technologies, scanners, such as 3D Systems Sense device that uses RealSense SF300 camera inside. It gives you the ability to take your device and simply take an object and scan it into 3D model. As simple as that, right? But today I want to bring something new to you, and that of 3D scanning of people. And to do that, I'd like to invite Farhad, the CEO of Naked Labs, to share with you some really exciting work that he's doing that we cannot live without soon, I guess.
Hey guys, so at Naked Labs, we wanted to completely change the way people track progress in health. That's why we invented Naked, the world's first body scanner for the home. In a nutshell, Naked's a full-length mirror embedded with RealSense technology that captures your 3D body model as the turntable rotates you 360 degrees. Next, I actually want to bring Vincent on stage to help me do a live demo.
I hope you're not jealous.
So, Vincent's actually been a beta user with us at Naked Labs since January this year. The way it's going to work is Vincent is going to step on the turntable. As Vincent steps on the turntable, sensors detect his presence and initiate the scan. Naked is now going to rotate Vincent 360 degrees in about 20 seconds while this Intel RealSense sensors capture his body frames at about 30 frames per second. Naked is now continuously stitching Vincent's 3D body models together to create his rich visual body model. Once the scan is complete, the scan is then uploaded to the phone, where I'll show you here. And once all that information is uploaded to the phone, which takes about a minute, we have Vincent right here. For the purpose of the time, what we've done is we've actually scanned Vincent a little bit earlier, and we're going to show you how his scan looks. So here you are, Vincent, all in 3D. We can look at Vincent at any angle that we want. Up there, if we had actually tracked Vincent this week, we would have had different scans of him up here. What we can also do is go here and look at Vincent's volumetric body fat percentage. This is significantly more accurate than the impedance systems you have in the market today for consumers. On top of that, we have his weight, and what RealSense and 3D scanning is able allowed us to do is actually go down and measure any part of Vincent's body that we want. We can see whether his arms are symmetric.
So he needs more exercise on the left.
He does, yeah, and you can tell Vincent really doesn't skip leg day, so which is pretty cool. We can also see Vincent's waist and basically track all these measurements over time. So as Vincent uses the device more and more, we can have a graph on the bottom how his waist is changing over time and have metrics like hip to waist ratio. But what's really cool is we can actually look how Vincent looked in past and compare it to where he is now. This is Vincent earlier this year. You can see actually, Vincent, you look good. You've done well. So we can actually see Vincent has lost a tremendous amount of volume around the stomach area. And whilst doing that, he's able to maintain the muscular composure that he has. And what we've seen with Naked is that this rich visual context has been extremely motivating to help people reach their fitness goal. And that's what we do at Naked. Thank you. You can actually pre-order Naked now at www.naked.fit and it'll start shipping in March 2017. And if you want to get a scan, just come visit us downstairs. We're in booth 386. Thanks, guys.
Great. Thank you, Farhad. So with those products, we are convinced that those are only subset of areas where real-time sensing technologies can apply. So we as Intel would like to get this technology out in the hands of innovators like Bread and Farhad's companies. So we have refreshed our developer tools and resources as well. And I'm very proud to show you that there's a wide portfolio of technologies that developers can use. Whether you are a system builder, or researcher, or a software company, or looking for applications, the developer kits go all the way from dev cameras that are simply connected with a USB cable, and you get this full real-time RGBD pair of images, and you can build your applications with SR300 and R200, to ZR300 developer kit that brings the fisheye camera with peripheral feature tracking, as well as motion sensing capabilities, to robotic development kit. If you'd like to simply get a turnkey solution, we pair up the RealSense peripheral along with an Aeon app board that has Intel's Atom processor on it, along with IOs that are suitable for robotic developers. To Intel Joule developer kit with our next generation processor technology in there that Brian mentioned. We paired that up with the RealSense ZR300 peripheral device as well. The drone development kit with Intel Aero platform that I presented earlier. And last but not the least, the one that Brian said would be a dream for the developers, is a complete all-in-one system that we call Intel Euclid. So with that, let me tell you a little bit about Intel Euclid. So Euclid is, can I hold up one?
Sure.
Okay, so this one actually has a battery connected in the back as well. It combines a RealSense with depth sensing, color picture, with fisheye camera for motion tracking, as well as IMUs, plus the software such as visual, inertial, odometry, all into one form factor, plus the connectivity. So you're able to wirelessly stream information back and forth between any system and the Euclid device. So to tell you more about Euclid, and just to show hands-on how a developer might use it and how it makes their life easy, I'd like Amit to explain to you how Euclid works and show some examples. Amit.
Thanks, Ajay. So as you said, Euclid is basically only one perception device. We have everything we need to create a robotics application. This is our focus. It runs Ubuntu and ROS, as the other guys are using as well. So a lot of robotic companies and researchers and prototypers. It comes with this web interface that you can, see hopefully soon. So you can connect to this device wirelessly.
Do you want to switch back to the screen over there, the laptop screen? Could you switch to the laptop screen, please?
So this interface, you can actually, it's a web interface. So you can connect wirelessly to this device and use your phone or your tablet or whatever you want to monitor the device and get to start all kind of applications. So, for example, this one has a...
Can you switch to this screen?
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Perfect, thank you very much. So this is the interface actually here that we can see. And we have a couple of applications already over here.
So what's important is he's not connected with that PC, simply wirelessly communicating between the Euclid device and the computer.
Exactly. So I just turned on this scenario. Scenario is like an application that has all kind of processes inside. This one is just running the camera and motion models. And I can also view the data in real time. So I can see what's going on here. I can see the depth data, so I can see all of you over there. I can take it down here. I can also see the motion models. So it's the fisheye and IMU we talked about before. So I can get some data and understand what the system is receiving and seeing. This is extremely important when I get this device first time, like out of the box, and I can already see what it actually can do and sense. So as a developer, probably in the BK keynote, you saw the person tracking application. How a developer creates such an application using this utility. So very simply, just creating a new application here.
Just to explain, all of these use cases that are already built in as the developer tools. But if you're a researcher who'd like to use the raw data and create your new computer vision applications, you could do that as well. But with this interface, you're able to pick and select the modules from the software that you want for your system.
Exactly. So there are some predefined, some of them are open source, like the RTM map, if you know, and you use some of the solution. And some of them are proprietary, like the RealSense person tracking middleware. So I just selected the camera and the person tracking. I'll give this, for example, a follower name. This is the name of my scenario. Just save the scenario.
So you save the scenario that you want for this demo?
Yeah, and it's greater than you want over there. And its rectangle is green, so it means it's working.
Okay.
We will go to see if it's
working. So you loaded up person tracking, so it should be tracking.
It should be tracking, yeah. So again, one of the things developers, you want to see that the device is actually working. So as you can see now, it's tracking actually here on stage. Again, it's very, very useful if I want to see what's going on, if my camera is working, etc.
So you already saw the demo of a robot walking away from Brian's keynote. So that was this one, right? The Otis. But I think this one we haven't shown before. So by the way, these are cute looking robots, but really dumb ones. They're like less than $20, right? Simple Arduino boards and 3D printed plastic casing. So they look cute, but they're pretty rudimentary. What makes them special is you take the Euclid device and simply connect them up, and you've taken your dumb $20 robot and made it into a system that senses and understands the world and is autonomous, right?
Brings it to life.
By the way, it comes to life as soon as you connect. Eyes are blinking now. And remember, you could load up all of those software into this for it to function, such as tracking a person, autonomously navigating, creating a map of the world. We have some amazing stuff here, and we cannot wait to get it out there in the hands of developers. Those of you interested, please contact us for this. Thank you, Amit.
Thank you.
So this is not just about the hardware that we said, you already got a sense, all of the middleware libraries that we provide. To make it easy for people to take RealSense and Intel technologies and develop systems with it, we focused on entire system stack, from the cameras to processors with the specific hardware accelerators that I mentioned. You can, to give an example, if you wanted to take stereo pictures and calculate depth using general purpose processor, you'd consume 20 times the power than what a RealSense module does. So it's about special compute platforms. It's our open source APIs, along with the robotic operating system support, we said Linux, Windows, Android, a lot of low-level support we provide to a whole host of rich middleware libraries for understanding, recognition, tracking, and all this stuff. That's it. I want to end this presentation with something from our lab that hopefully will bring this goal of going from sensing to understanding to learning into reality. So what you see here is this is basically just an Intel cafeteria environment over there. And we have a device with RealSense ZR300 technology inside. And on the left, you're going to see, as we take a walk around Intel cafeteria, you're going to see two things. One, you're going to see real-time mapping, tracking, and localization, which is what we humans do. We take it for granted, but that's what we do. As long as I'm awake and moving around, I'm creating a constant 3D map of the wall. I'm always localizing myself with respect to the wall. I know where I am every moment. That's what keeps me balanced and moving. And I'm able to track myself at those points. So you want to be able to do that, whether it's an autonomous robot or a flying drone or a Mars reality headset. That's fundamental part of it. But another thing you're going to see is the system utilizing deep learning technologies would be able to recognize what it sees along the way. So let me just play this video. So here we're taking a walk, not just the location in the 3D space, but pay also attention to the orientation of the device. Like, which way are you tilting it? Which way are you? It's like your visual vestibular system that tells you which way you are moving your head. By the way, this is not a 3D scan, so you don't get confused. This is called a 2D occupancy map. It's a bird's eye view of the mapping the system is doing. You wanted to show 3D scan, you already saw the quality of the 3D scan that you get. Okay, let me tell you about this one. So what is that there? 77% confidence that that was a sofa. This is 93% confidence that that was a chair. So as you're walking around, you're not only creating 3D map, localizing, tracking yourself, you're also letting the system recognize what it sees. That's where you have the whole stack from sensing technologies to understanding technologies to recognition technologies, learning come together. We think that this is a glimpse of the future of intelligent, interactive, and autonomous devices. And applications are going to be a plethora of them. We just focused on a few of them today, and we would like to hear from you on what would you build with real-time sensing and understanding technology.